Welcome to another edition of Chess Chat, a program designed to give you, the viewer, a good understanding of the fascinating world of chess. I'm George Merejanian, Program Director of the Wachusett Chess Club at Fitchburg State University. This club meets every Wednesday evening from 7 to 11 in room C192 in the McKay Complex at the university. And with me today at the Fitchburg Access Television Center is our award-winning director, Darren Dame of Fitchburg. He's assisted by longtime Wachusett Chess Club member Brian Bigelow, both in the control room and behind the camera. And, but last but not least, is my longtime associate and colleague, Dave Kucher, my co-host. Good to see you, Dave.
Good to see you. Happy 2017.
Happy New Year to you, Dave. Well, Dave, today we're going to do a program on a grandmaster, an American grandmaster, who broke a world record for a blindfold simultaneous play.
Yeah.
And you learned about this. I learned about this at the same time. Who is this grandmaster, now an American grandmaster?
You're going to ask me to pronounce his name?
Well,
Timur Gareyev.
Gareyev, yes.
Gareyev.
Timur Gareyev. Timur Gareyev actually broke a record for playing the most number of players simultaneously while blindfold.
Yeah.
He had no sight of the board. We have some actually, in fact, let's show, do we want to show some photos of now,
sure,
of Timur,
yeah,
doing this?
Yeah.
He did this actually on the weekend of December 3rd and 4th, 2016, at the University of Nevada in Las Vegas. Again, he broke the record that was held by a German master, Mark Lang. Here is Timur, the king of, he's king of rap, but actually, this is he probably was at the Iowa Fair. This is probably event he was at. We don't know what this was.
I think this was a preparatory event.
Oh,
before
this event,
Las Vegas? I think so.
Oh, really? Before Las Vegas?
Yeah,
okay. Well, there's one photo of Timur. We have some others that we will show. But Timur actually was born. Now, he's 28 years old. He was born in Uzbekistan,
mm-hmm,
in the capital, Tashkent. Yeah. He grew up in Uzbekistan. But he came to the United States in his late teens. At the age of 17, he started playing in U.S. Chess Federation rated tournaments. His first tournament was in 2005, but he went to the University of Texas at Brownsville, graduated from the University of Texas at Brownsville,
yeah,
with a degree in business marketing. But of course, his profession now is being a professional chess player and doing exhibitions like
right,
this.
Right.
I think, I don't know whether he's gonna pursue a career in business marketing. He has a degree in it. But he did perform this great exhibition, broke a record.
Right.
Now he played 48 people. Here's a picture of him. He's on an exercise bike. Now wasn't he actually not only on the exercise bike during this exhibition, which how long did this whole exhibition take?
19 hours.
Yeah, a little over 19 hours.
I cannot imagine.
Can you imagine? This
no,
is mind-boggling that he's playing 48 people simultaneously, has no sight of the boy. He's blindfolded. In this picture, we don't see the blindfold.
There he is. Yeah.
Okay, but there he is on the bike. And he won 30, of the 48 games, he won 35. I think he lost 6 and drew 7. Okay, that adds up to 48.
Yeah.
Now, he actually played close to the 8. Here's a picture about.
Yeah,
now, this actually, he's wearing a T-shirt. What is that T-shirt? There's a little the quote at the bottom
right
of his T-shirt saying what? I close my eyes to see.
Yes.
You know, there's an artist, I think the French artist Paul Gauguin,
yep,
said that. That's a quote from the French artist Paul Gauguin. But this, he played close to 18 and a half hours. It started close to 8:30 on Saturday morning, December 3rd. It didn't get over until the wee hours of December 4th on a Sunday morning.
And you said there was a break.
There was a break. At least a half hour break where he had to stop and do nothing, because the fire department was called in because Timur had a personal chef who was making him little mini meals, you know, during the day while he was doing this. And the chef set off the fire alarm, and the fire department came, And they declared, okay, fine. But it took like a half hour away from the exhibition.
Which makes it more amazing, because for that half hour, he had to keep all those games in his head.
That's very true, yeah. Now, it's interesting, you know, blindfold chess, blindfold simultaneous chess, actually goes back, way back to the early years of chess. You know, when the great, you know, the great French player, Philidor, mm-hmm. André Philidor?
Yeah.
When he played three players blindfold, the press, especially the French press, they raved about it. They thought it was phenomenal.
Yeah.
They said, how could somebody?
Well, it is phenomenal.
Now, have you tried it? You said you've tried it with one game?
Yeah. Well, last night I was telling my wife and daughter what the show was going to be about today.
Yes.
And they said, well, how do you do that? And I said, I don't know, because when I was a teenager, I tried it with one game.
Right.
And we got about 10 moves in, and I said, you know, make this move, and my opponent said, you can't, that piece isn't there. So I said, well,
yeah, right.
I give up, I can't do this.
Right.
You know, yeah. So I couldn't even get 10 moves in.
Yeah, I had the same problem. I could not possibly, I've tried it with one game, doing a blindfold, you know, but yes, once you're told by your opponent, you can't do that,
you get
frustrated, you say no.
Obviously you've forgotten what the board looks like, and yeah, you can't continue.
Okay, but you know, some great players of the past, like, you know, Harry Nelson Pillsbury, you know, who was born in Somerville, Massachusetts,
yep.
One of the top American players. He did 20 blindfold games in Philadelphia in 1900. And then we have people like Alexander Aliekhin, the world champion.
Mm-hmm.
He played, how many did he play? 34,
yeah.
I think, in Chicago during the 1930s. So we've had a number of players, you know, top players and lesser known players who can do this.
Yeah.
But it is mind-boggling.
It is.
How you can play blindfold multiple players and keep track of the games in your mind. Now, we're going to present to our viewers, Dave, one of the games from this simul played in Las Vegas that Timur performed. And it was against a master, a national master. Now, this game was probably one of the fastest games played, because it's a short game, a tactical game.
Yeah.
And the master, his name was Tom Brownscombe, and he lives in Nevada.
Okay.
And so we're going to present this, and one of the interesting things about this simul is Timur did not have white on all the boards. Usually in an exhibition, the person performing the exhibition gets the white pieces on all the boards.
Mm-hmm.
This was not the case in this exhibition that Timur did. He chose to take black on a number of games, which is highly unusual. So what did Tom Brownscombe play as white for his first move in this blindfold simultaneous exhibition?
He opens up with e4.
Okay, a very...
very standard.
Standard, very popular opening move. So what Timur did was respond with the pawn on e7 to e5. So he plays e5, there's a double king pawn, e-pawn, both e-pawns have come out. All right, so what did white do on the second move?
Brownscombe plays knight to f3 for his second move.
Knight a3, it attacks the pawn on e5, and of course black wants to defend that pawn.
Mm-hmm.
So what Timur did was play knight c6. Knight c6. All right, white's third move coming up.
Plays bishop to b5, attacking the knight that's defending the pawn.
Okay, now, This is an opening that has a name. What is this called?
I say the Rye Lopez. Rye Lopez.
Now, when I grew up, when I started playing chess in the late 1950s, we knew this as the Rye Lopez. In fact, in the English-speaking countries, this is known as the Rye Lopez opening.
Mm-hmm.
It was named after a 16th century Spanish priest, Rye Lopez de Segura, who wrote a book on chess.
Okay.
That appeared in 1561.
Wow.
Yeah. In fact, it's one of the earliest books on chess ever. But most of the world, even nowadays, you know what they call this?
The Spanish?
The Spanish.
Okay.
The Spanish opening, right. So there are players who call this either Rye Lopez opening or the Spanish opening. Either one is acceptable. All right. So what Timur did in response to Bishop B5, the Spanish opening, he attacked the bishop. He put the question to the bishop by playing a6. He wants to know what white's intentions are. Is that bishop, which is on b5, there to eliminate that knight, or does white retreat that bishop?
Right.
All right, so what did a white do on the...
He retreats, which is what's usually done.
Right. Now, Bobby Fischer By the way, the Ree Lopez opening, the Spanish opening, was the opening that Bobby Fischer played all the time when, mm-hmm. when he played at the double king pawn. But he believed in the Spanish opening. And in his later years, Fischer used to take the knight. He played the exchange, so-called exchange variation. But most players, I think, retreat.
Yep.
It's very rare to see the exchange variation. So what Timur did on his fourth move was play knight f6. So he develops another piece, attacks the pawn on e4. So what does white do in response to this?
Again, standard move is just a castle.
Right. Now, you see, he chose not to defend the pawn. You don't have to defend that pawn.
Right. Yet,
because that pawn can be gotten back in a number of ways, with, especially if the knight takes the pawn, the
right,
rook moves
e1, attacks.
Or even playing d4. That pawn is, he doesn't win a pawn because he has to give the pawn back.
Right.
All right, so here on response to castling, now here is an interesting departure. It's not a commonly played move. Timur played bishop c5. Now this is not usual, bishop c5, because more commonly seen is playing the bishop to e7.
Right.
That's well known. Also, even taking the pawn, which is called the open variation, can be played.
Mm-hmm.
But Timur played bishop c5, which is a very active placement of the bishop.
Right.
Now, you know this has a name, this defense. This is a defensive move. It's known as the Müller defense.
Mm-hmm.
It's named after a 20th century Danish chess master named Jürgen Müller. He published an analysis of this variation in a Swedish chess magazine in 1903.
Okay.
And because of that analysis in that Swedish chess magazine, they gave the name Müller, the Müller defense, to this variation, bishop c5. All right, okay. So what does Brownscombe, the master, play on his sixth move against bishop c5?
He plays rook to e1.
Oh, so now he wants to protect the pawn.
Yep.
It was under attack. Okay, in response to that, Timur Gureyev now plays knight g4. What is he threatening by playing knight g4?
Well, for one thing, bishop taking here, forking the king and the rook.
Okay, so because he has a double attack on that pawn on f2, that pawn has to be defended.
Right.
Now, what does white do here in response? He comes up.
Plays rook e2.
Yeah. Now I know that some players would probably brought the rook back to f1, but no, this makes sense. Just bring the rook
right.
up,
yeah.
Have the rook defend the pawn on f2. All right, so rook e2 was played. Now Timur says, okay, it's now time for me to castle.
Yep.
So that's what he did. That was his seventh move. All right, white's move now. All right, now what do we do?
White's eighth move, he plays c3.
All right, c3
preparing perhaps to push the d pawn.
All right. Okay, now, what do we do after c3? Well, Timur says, okay, it's now time to thrust in the center here. d5. He plays d5, attacks the pawn on e4. All right, so are we going to see now maybe the first mistake of the game?
Yeah, so yeah. It's interesting. Here's the guy with the side of the board.
Right, he's got he's a master.
Master.
Who has probably studied opening theory,
yeah.
And he makes a mistake.
Yeah.
Now, what did he play? And then we'll show what he should have played.
He plays, he takes d5.
Right. Okay.
Which is going to have the unfortunate consequence of allowing Timur to push this pawn.
Okay. Now, what he should have played, instead of playing the pawn on e4, taking the pawn on d5, was to play the pawn on d2 to d4, right?
Well, the one game I found in the database,
or
d3.
Or even that. Okay, even
d3
the, okay,
was
so
played.
Defend, so even that's a good move. Just defend the pawn.
Defend the pawn, or like you said, d4 also would work.
Okay, either one. All right, so let's go back to what white played. He played
so
e takes d5. All right. So I guess Brownscombe may have thought maybe the queen was going to come back and take the pawn on d5, but no. Timur is going to just push the pawn to e4. That was his ninth move. e4, that, of course, attacks the knight. And, of course, the rook is not going to take the pawn because the rook is here on e2 defending the pawn on f2. with the king.
Sure, right. If he had taken, then the knight can come in here, fork.
Oh, yes, it would be a fork. He'd be forking the queen and the rook, and the rook would be lost because the queen would have to move. All right, so what did the white do in response to e4?
So again, the master, with the sight of the board, makes another mistake. Probably his best move at this point would have just been d4.
Attack the bishop.
Attacking the bishop.
That is, give the knight, but also get the bishop in return.
Right, although he could have captured in passing.
He could take en passant in passing.
But still, the computer suggests that this was probably the best move. He's already at a disadvantage.
So he's actually made an opening mistake. As early as the ninth move, made a mistake here. All right, so what happened here?
And he makes another mistake by taking.
So the D takes the knight on
C6.
On C6.
For his 10th move.
In response to that, Timur takes the pawn on E4 and captures the knight on F3. So E takes F3 is his move, okay? So we have minor pieces off here. Now what does white do? It's now the 11th move coming up for white.
Yep, and again.
Another mistake?
He makes another mistake.
We're seeing mistake after mistake.
Right, by a master.
Right.
Who has full sight of the board. Again, it's suggested that D4 is probably best, blocking out
the
bishop.
Right,
attacking the bishop.
Stop the attack on
blocking that. Okay. But instead, he captured. G takes F3.
Okay. Now, in response to that, what he did here? This must have come as a surprise. This is mind-boggling that Timur saw this continuation
in his brain.
he has no sight of the game. But again, he is seeing the game in his mind. He is seeing this game. What Timur did was play knight takes the pawn on h2. Knight takes h2. What is this? He cannot take that knight. Shall we show actually why that knight cannot be taken? Let's take a look. He's offering the sacrifice of the knight.
Yeah.
If the king takes the knight, doesn't this queen now come over here with the check?
Yeah.
The check here, okay, fine. And now what are we doing?
And then if the king were to come back.
Right. Now, can we actually, I see now, can we actually bring this bishop now? Oh, no, we just come over here. Can we go over here now? Like this, isn't this good? Now we're threatening with this here. We're threatening the check here.
Right.
The pawn push is not going to help because we're just simply going to take with the bishop. We're still going to, it's going to lead to mate. This is a forced mate because how do we stop this? It's going to be check here. Followed by check here, and it's a mate.
Right.
Yeah, so this would be a mistake. All right, so let's put the queen back here.
Yep.
All right, so the knight takes on h8.
Right.
If white were to take that knight, it's going to be a forced mate.
For sure.
All right, so what white did in response was not take that. What he did was play the rook what?
Rook to e5.
Okay, now what does that do?
Attacking this bishop that's taking part in the attack.
Okay. All right, so rook e5. All right, so what are we doing here? After rook e5, well, what Timur did was play the queen to f6, and it attacks the rook.
Attacking the rook.
Also puts a double attack on the pawn on f3.
Yeah.
Okay? So what does white do in response to queen f6?
And here again.
Another mistake?
Another mistake, okay. Although he's already in serious trouble. Yes, White's in serious trouble. Again, d4.
Yes.
Guarding the rook,
and
attacking
all,
the
yes,
bishop.
Yes, right. Guarding the rook and
is,
also.
Is probably the best, but.
Right. He didn't do that.
No matter what, he's still in trouble.
Right.
He actually took.
So here's the greed factor. So he decided, okay, I'll take the. Win the piece. Okay.
Yeah.
Not realizing by capturing that that bishop on c5, he's allowing this knight to take the pawn on f3 with check.
Yeah.
Knight f3, check. All right, so the king has to move. The queen's not going to certainly take the knight and lose the white losing the queen. So where does that king go?
He's going to go to g2.
All right.
His only hope, really, I think, was king to f1.
Right.
To avoid a forced mate. He's in serious trouble.
He's already in serious trouble.
The bishop.
This king is so exposed.
Yeah.
Yeah. So what he did was he played
king. King to g2.
King g2. All right. Now here comes another fantastic move.
You know, right.
For Timur to see this whole, this is a combination. Mm-hmm. And it's very difficult to see combinations when you're sighted. And it's phenomenal if you can do it when you're no sight.
As well as keeping track of 47 other games.
Exactly. So what Timur did after king g2 on his 14th move was play bishop h3, check. He's offering that bishop.
Which white takes.
In fact, he has to. So after king takes on h3, now Timur comes with queen h4 check. Queen h4 check, and now white only has one move, right?
Right, king g2.
King g2 is his move, okay. All right, now here is what Timur did. He played queen g4 check, okay. And now what happens? Now, the viewers will have to see why the king cannot go in the corner. What is wrong with king h1?
All right, king h1
would lead to an immediate mate.
Immediate mate.
That's checkmate right there.
That's checkmate, yeah.
So the king can't go to h1.
Right.
So after this check on g4, the king only has one move.
Has to go to f1.
Goes to king f1, okay. And now comes an automatic move, you know.
Sure, yeah.
Knight h2 check, and the king only has one square.
Yeah, only one square. King e1.
King e1. Okay.
Where he started.
Okay, and now here comes the last move of the game.
Right.
And Timur could have done it with either way.
Either rook.
Either rook.
Yeah.
We have two rooks here, but he decided to play the rook on f8 to e8, check, and now. Of course, the king cannot move, and with the queen, which is the only move, would lead to an immediate mate. In fact, the only...
Well, he could throw the rook in the way.
He could throw the rook in the way on e5. The rook would take the rook on e5 check, but the queen would still have to block, and then it would be mate down here. Either with the rook takes on e2, the queen, or the queen takes e2, it would be mate. Okay, so... This was a very short game. I'm sure maybe the master was embarrassed to lose in such a time. I'm sure there were some lower-rated players who were playing this exhibition. Who were still playing.
Right.
Again, did I mention that actually among the 48 players that Timur played against, at least 20 of them were rated Class A and above.
Yeah, which makes it all the more amazing.
Makes it more amazing. Now, let's see how much time. We still have time. Can I point out some things about blindfold play? I mentioned, for example, Philidor in 1783 playing three people simultaneously.
Yeah.
And then Harry Nelson Pillsbury. Well,
do you want to talk about the brain scan I mentioned?
Oh, yes. Let's talk about the brain scan.
I think it was in Southern California. It might have been the University of Southern California.
Yes.
I'm not sure. They did a brain scan of Gariev to see, try and figure out what's different about the brain of such a person. One of the things they found out with the preliminary investigation, let's see if I can get the quote right.
Yes.
The scan suggests that Gariev's visual network is more highly connected to other brain parts than in most people.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, it's interesting when we talk about Gariev seeing combinations in a way he is, right? Because they're saying his visual cortex is more highly connected to other parts of the brain than most people.
Wow.
So that's, you know, he doesn't have sight of the board.
Right.
But
in his
brain
he
has sight of the board.
He definitely has sight.
Yeah.
And that is mind-boggling.
Yeah,
to think that there are individuals who could do this.
Yeah.
You know. But I mentioned, for example, the history of blindfold simultaneous play goes way back in chess, But I mentioned, we mentioned Philidor, we mentioned Harry Nelson Pillsbury. But let me actually throw out some other people. Paul Morphy. Now, anyone who's into chess knows the name Paul Morphy, one of the great American players of the 19th century.
Right.
Now, he played in 1858 in Paris, eight strong players, and he won six games and drew two there. Then you had somebody from England. Now this is not a game, this is a person who's not known to many chess players, but Joseph Henry Blackburn.
Yeah, I've heard that name.
You've heard the name, Blackburn. He played 20. He played 20, up to 16 opponents, you know, back over more than 100 years ago. The first official world champion, Wilhelm Steinitz, who actually came to the United States, I think from Austria, became world champion, the first official world champion. He played six players, you know, in Dundee, Scotland in 1867. Alexander Ljechin, I mentioned, a former world champion.
Right.
He was world champion in the late 1920s. Well, in 1924, there was a big tournament in New York City at the Alamac Hotel. I don't know if that hotel, I don't think that hotel even exists now.
Yeah.
But in 1924, he played 26 players, and he won 16 games and lost five and drew five. Then Ljechin set a world record in Chicago in 1934 by playing 32 games. Now he's up, we've upped the number of players. He won 19, lost four, and drew nine. And then this German master by the name of Mark Lang, he set a record by playing, if I can find it, well, he actually, in November 2011, he played 46 players in Germany. Sondheim, Germany was the place. That was 46 in 2011. Well, here it is now, 5 years later, actually, December 2016,
yeah.
Timur comes back and breaks that record by playing 48.
48, okay.
Now, I wouldn't be surprised if there's somebody out there who wants to break Timur's record of 48, but I have a feeling this is going to stand for some time.
It Timur's wouldn't surprise record. Me if he, you know, tries to break his own record.
He may choose to do that, but he may be content with saying, okay, I'm happy with the 48 players that I've played. And again, but I think in the world of chess, there's always those players out there who want to beat the other player's record. Yeah. So
that's not an easy one to break. I mean,
and I think I mentioned to you before we went on the air that one of our former Wachusett Chess Club champions, Alan Bennett, who lived in Chelmsford but was a Wachusett Chess Club champion, when our club was meeting at the St. Joseph Club in Cleghorn, Alan Bennett, I saw him perform a blindfold exhibition playing four people.
Yeah.
But even that, playing four was phenomenal.
It is. Even one. I mean,
even one. And I went to an exhibition in at the Boylston Chess Club in Boston back in, it had to be like in the early 80s, possibly late 70s, where Master Bill Roberti has written a lot of books on poker. He was a backgammon. Well, he performed, he played eight people at the Boylston Chess Club in Boston. And one of the things, most memorable things about that was one of the players announced a move that was relayed to him, and he told him, he says, you can't do that move. It's impossible. He corrected the sighted person who had full sight of the board and told him, you can't play that move. That's an illegal move.
Yeah.
So these blindfold players are phenomenal. Again, we had to present to our viewers a player like Timur Gareev, who has actually set a new world record, and I expect this will stand for some number of years. So I think we're going to wrap it up and wish everybody a happy new year. And we'll see you next time on Chess Chat. We promise to bring you an exciting game, hopefully a short tactical game that it would be easy to explain.
Mm-hmm.
So stay tuned for the next edition of Chess Chat.